Welcome to the podcast with me, your host, Dr. Debra Durst, and I have my special guest, repeat guest, Dr. Spencer. I'm grateful enough to have him on again, talking about some healing peptides. So how this
started out, we've done a couple of these podcasts now, talking about how to recover from injury, how to recover from surgery, and so we've talked on about nutrition and our micro and macronutrients that we need to be taking before and after surgery, as well as in the reparative process for injury. The next level is what we're talking about now. That includes getting your hormone levels correct, vitamin D levels correct, but then the next level beyond that are peptides. And so that's how we got to know each other. I had my knee replaced and I wanted to do something. What else can I do to make this recovery better and faster? And so Deb suggested, well, have you looked into peptides? And so what's a peptide? Well, you know, it's several amino acids long, and one that really worked well was BPC-157. And so I've suggested that to many of my patients, and so that's why we're here talking about this, is to explore that a little bit, where it's useful, and if you can tell a little bit to the audience about how you use it.
Well, and I really think that that brings up the point that you are not only looking for something initially that you didn't know existed, really, because none of us did in traditional medicine, but also offering that to your patients because you want, you know, to offer other things that you find that are beneficial so that they have other, you know, ways of healing and getting better quicker. And so I love that you actually will branch out of, you know, the box of traditional, I don't want to say traditional medicine. I actually don't think of orthopedic surgery as traditional medicine. Traditional methods, right? Because it's surgical. But I think that at least now, like, you're offering your patients everything. So you bullet pointed it to begin with, nutrition, vitamin D, vitamin C. And we have other podcasts on some of those so far, and some of them we'll have in the future more specifically. But we've talked about this in the past, and he bullet pointed everything. But I think, again, he was open enough to peptides. And so I'd love to see if you guys have had experience, anyone listening have had experience with orthopedic surgeons and, you know, maybe even knowledge of and offering up any peptides, because I don't think it's very common yet, but it's definitely gaining momentum, I think.
Yeah, I think the peptide world and the cellular medicine world has really kind of started first with bodybuilding, with exercise, and now has kind of spilled over into how can we make things better from a reparative regenerative process. So my experience with it was that from my standpoint, it accelerated the healing process. Now, I've got an N of one, so I've had one knee replacement, but according to my therapist and physician, did really well. And that's owing to my therapist and physician as well. But there are a couple questions I wanted to ask you about BPC-157. Now, it's a 15 amino acid peptide, and it's been around for a long time. It can be taken orally and sub-Q. And so from an oral standpoint, I think it really helps from a GI standpoint, healing and ulcerative colitis and Crohn's and things like that. But we're talking about more using it from a systemic standpoint and subcutaneous. And so that's how I used it. There are people who have used it site-specific. I've talked to a couple. Can you comment about the site specificity use, the proximity to the injury, to the surgery using BPC-157?
As far as BPC and where you're giving it. So I feel like if you're giving BPC in an injection, like, yes, you can give it in a capsule form or injection. So I feel like if you're giving it in an injection and you're giving it sub-Q, it's going systemically no matter what. So there's some reports that the closer to the injury, the better. And so I've heard that. You know, we've done a couple experiments on our patients, specifically one with bilateral knee pain, not approaching surgery, just some chronic pain. Injection closer to one knee and no improvement in that knee over the other. But I have heard that. But again, systemically, I would make the argument it doesn't matter. It's going systemically, so it'll go everywhere, which is why you also get GI effects that are positive with BPC when you're on it. I do feel like you should use it in an injectable form when you're trying to heal, and especially in a preoperative, perioperative, or postoperative period, you should definitely use it subcutaneously. And I think capsule, if you were looking at GI only, you get the benefit of GI when you're doing it injectable. But I just think it's the most potent. And so when we're preparing your patients for surgery, we definitely want injectable.
Injectable.
And it's so easy, just so you know. So when you're doing an injection of peptides, it's a liquid and it's in an insulin syringe and it's a very small amount. So you're really getting subcutaneous tissue in the leg or in the abs. And so it doesn't hurt. It's small. Just if you haven't done an injectable at home, and we have a lot of patients that are a little resistant to that at first. I don't want to inject. I've never done that. I'd have problems, but almost across the board, no one does, and they're able to do it. So just right. So you know. But yes, was there another question in there? I couldn't. Definitely, I prefer injectable. For
yeah,
sure.
So do you treat many GI patients that have mm-hmm. chronic inflammatory bowel disease with BPC? I mean, that's a rare thing, I think.
It's actually kind of funny because I probably have used BPC on almost – across the board on a lot of things. It's one of my favorite peptides. I shouldn't say almost anything, but almost any complaint that I see. So if I see somebody with a vague diagnosis, and you know what I'm talking about, like they've been to the specialist, they've had every test, and they get either, an irritable bowel, a fibromyalgia, kind of musculoskeletal, or just a vague thing, like some maybe autoimmune, but they're having trouble figuring out, all the way from those conditions to corneal abrasions to, vertigo that is like post-COVID. We saw some vertigo patients that had no diagnosis and severe vertigo that would get improvement with BPC. So what I frequently do, interstitial cystitis was one. I will say I've never seen it used in this. I haven't used it in it before, but I'm a huge fan. It heals lots of things. It's probably worth trying, but why don't we Google, or why don't you look into it? So I give them an informational sheet on BPC. So they actually have it in the term. Then I refer them over to the podcast, or the YouTube. But I also let them go search. Can they find people that have used it? And almost across the board, you can. Somebody that's used it. So again, those are case studies. But if you're having pain, you're getting treatments that aren't improving, and you have chronic pain, what do you have to lose for trying something that may heal that doesn't have adverse effects with it? So,
right,
and that's kind of what we do. Somebody's sitting in front of me and they're suffering in some way, and we in traditional medicine are not offering them solutions to help with that. And they've been diagnosed and they've had every test done. So there's not either a specific diagnosis or there is, but there's no treatments that really help.
Okay.
So yes, I've used it in almost everything.
I've read reports and seen some animal studies where BPC actually increases the number of blood vessels, and so mm-hmm. it's angiogenic. It also increases the ability for fibroblasts to differentiate and multiply through mm-hmm. fibroblast growth factor. What do you think is like the most important thing that BPC does, maybe a hierarchy of how it works?
So I don't know that there's like an exact mechanism for, all the different effects. I think inflammation is the key. So I think it decreases inflammation. So it's a 15, like you mentioned, a 15 amino acid peptide, and it simulates a healing peptide that is normally released from the stomach. And so you're giving the body back that ability to heal, but inflammation, so it does decrease inflammation significantly. And inflammation is a lot of the issue with a lot of the conditions we're talking about, interstitial cystitis being one. Itis at the end is inflammation. All joint and orthopedics, and it's been used a ton in that. But a lot of it comes down to decreasing inflammation, really, with that. But again, improving collagen and improving the type of collagen formed, increasing effects and anabolic effects on like the muscle. And so, but it has all kinds of like decreased opiate, tolerance. Sometimes there's some other effects that I don't think they have exact mechanisms for.
Yeah, isn't that interesting how you've mm-hmm. got this small little 15 amino acid yeah. peptide that must mimic so many different things, yet mm-hmm. doesn't really seem to have any deleterious side effects, how beneficial that is. I wonder mm-hmm. if it's been used in inflammatory diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, where you've got systemic inflammation, and if things like thymosin have been used in situations like that, where you can really systemically reduce inflammation and how that would work. I'd be interested to know.
So there are some. So like I think when you and I first met and discussed peptides, TB4, you know, so you're talking about thymus-related peptides. So TB4 was one of them. TA1 was another. TA1 was more immune-modulating. TB4 was an anti-inflammatory. And again, wasn't available for a little while, I think is now becoming available again. I think, again, there was some use for it with COVID, which may not have been approved, may have interfered with it. I don't know the details, but it did go away.
Someone's making money off of it.
It did go away during that time frame. Yeah, so there was something during that time frame, but I think it is now becoming available again. But TB500 took over for that. But those thymus-related hormones and thymulin 500, which is kind of similar, the TB500, so yes, they're immune modulating, they're affecting the inflammatory pathway in so many different ways. And so beneficial, and you can stack TB500 and or TB4, which is what we used to use and may bring back with BPC, as you know. And so that's huge, but I think that using that TB500 or TB4 in that acute inflammatory stage is probably the key, where BPC you can use throughout and indefinitely if you want to, which we've discussed in another podcast, whether you really needed to come off of it. Right. And for BPC, you don't, you know, I mean, again, I don't think you're going to find any solid source for, you know, a duration, but look at traditional medicine. I mean, we're trained to put people on medicine and never take them off.
Yeah, you sort of stay yes. on it. But
yeah, and then we're like sitting here and I'm almost hesitant to say, yes, you can indefinitely be on it. But then in traditional medicine, we can put them on antihypertensives indefinitely. You know, yeah. statins
the
indefinitely.
Is this, is, yeah. this is mitogenic and angiogenic, and that makes you kind of give you a little bit of pause, like, you know, is this something that we can stay on? Because is this something that could be deleterious if we stay on it for a long period of time? But it sounds like from your standpoint, the decrease in inflammation is the number one thing that it does. And then with that, also BPC increasing the number of growth hormone receptors, then that allows you the recovery and reparative process too. So, man, it just sounds like an incredible peptide, and everything that I've read and heard about it is that it is that. And so if people in the audience have used it, have had experience with it, either from a GI standpoint, from a musculoskeletal standpoint, let us know. We'd be really interested to see how you've used it. Was it site-specific? Have you used it in a specific area? I think I've had one guy that tried using it for lateral epicondylitis and injected it right there, and it worked exceedingly well. He's like, within 2 weeks, I was better. So, I mean, that's one anecdotal report, which is worth one anecdotal report, so it doesn't really mean a whole lot, but... Mm-hmm. It's something, you know, it's something.
Well, and I think that's what I love about you is like your traditional, so it's almost like regenerative meets orthopedic surgery, and that's what we're talking about. And we're all about healing on both sides of it, but you will push outside of that traditional box and try something else. So, but still kind of with that basic science, and I love the science, but I think you can't be in regenerative medicine without pushing outside of that a little bit more than usual, because again, our studies are going to put us 10 years out and we might not find good and big studies on a peptide, but insulin was the first peptide. And, and that's, we've been using now forever. So we knew it worked in the 30s, you know, and so peptides, that was insulin, the first one. That's how far back it goes,
right?
You know, and there's so many that are being researched right now. And so many good, you know, studies out there that support, and I haven't seen a lot of negative, you know, but again, we don't have long-term and we don't have large studies.
Right. I've yet to see some negative stuff on this yet, even CMAX improving your neurobiology. But, you know, orthopedics, we're simply construction workers. We're building and repairing stuff. The atom has almost been split on how well we can fix something, how well we can replace something. Yeah, we're tweaking around with different materials properties and things like that, but it's the biology. It's enhancing the biology. And the way it enhances biology is what we've talked about, nutrition, micronutrients, macronutrients, the vitamin D, vitamin C, and then peptides. So if anyone has interest in this, and if anyone has used it before, please contact us. We'd be super interested in hearing about that.
Definitely. Any experiences you want to share, or if you know somebody that's had an experience, I would love to know how often somebody is being offered, or, you know, even in, or are you searching and finding, you know, other options for healing such as peptides? So we would love to heal or to hear if you've had like a BPC experience, even if it was one of those non-orthopedic, I guess, injuries, because again, it is being used for so many different things, but it is just case studies being reported out there. So we would love to hear that. Share, please. And let us know if there's any other peptides as far as healing that you would like to talk about, or anything else related to nutrition and surgery, or vitamin levels leading into surgery and improving healing. We'd love to hear all about that. And if you want us to talk more on something, let us know. Like, subscribe, share with friends. Thank you.